Okay, and thank you everyone for coming virtually to listen. I wish we were able to meet in person, but maybe that will be for another opportunity. Okay.
Just one second. Actually, one thing which I would like to say, if people can turn on their cameras, if they're fine with turning on the camera, it'll be good to see people's faces and stuff. If you can, please do. Reid, go ahead. Yeah.
Great. And also, please feel free to ask questions, comments, and so on, to make it a bit more, I don't know, personal or interactive, if possible. Okay. All right. So the topic of the talk is high dimensional expanders. And the first part of the talk will focus on expanders, just good old one dimensional expanders, to put these things in context and remind us of stuff that we know and love about these objects. So what is an expander graph? Well, maybe the first thing that comes to mind is that it's a robust kind of a network. So it's a graph or a network that's very highly connected on one hand. So you can reach from any node to any other node. But on the other hand, it's very sparse. So we always think of expanders as every node is only connected to a small number of neighbors, and yet somehow together the whole thing is very, very highly connected. So this captures some kind of a contradiction or tension, which makes this object very interesting and useful. You can, for example, so there are many ways to define an expander. One way is to say, well, you can remove a lot of edges from a given expander. And even after you've done that, and you can even try to do it adversarially, the graph is still going to remain very highly connected. So you might, if you are allowed to remove a lot of edges, you might completely disconnect a node or many few nodes, but there's gonna be a huge connected component that is still highly connected. Actually, it will still be an expander. Okay, so that's kind of qualitatively how to think of expanders, and I'm not going to go into formal definitions. There are several of them. Let me talk a little bit about expanders that are used throughout our field, throughout computer science. Of course, there are so many different uses. There are so many applications for expanders almost everywhere. And even outside of CS, like in mathematics, people study expansion and expanders, and it's been a very successful area of research. So one example, which I find very striking, is for error correcting codes. The reason that I find it very striking is because a priori, there's nothing to do between error correcting codes and expansion. So what are error correcting codes? We transmit strings of bits when we communicate digitally. We also use strings of bits to store our data. And noise and errors happen all the time. So even if I wanted to store a specific string of bits, when I did the save operation, maybe some of the bits get flipped. And that's something that happens, and it's beyond our control. So what we need to do is be able to recover from these little bit flips. And the way we do it is by encoding. We encode the transmission so that even if a few bits got flipped, we can correct. And when we do this encoding, we want to make sure there's not too much of overhead. So it's not like, instead of writing a zero, I'm going to repeat 10 times, 0, 0, 0, 0. And then for every one, I'll repeat it another 10 times. That's not very efficient. Error correcting codes give us much, much more efficient ways of encoding data. So the way we think of it geometrically is that a linear error correcting code is a linear subspace. And the points in this subspace, the elements of this subspace, are strings that are pairwise far apart. When I say far apart, I mean in Hamming distance. And that enables us to be sure that if only a few bits of error occurred, we get some other string that's not part of our linear subspace, but it's very easy. There's only gonna be one legal code word that you know that's where your message came from. Of course, the algorithmic question here is the following. Given a received word, how do you remove the errors? How do you find the nearest string that's a valid code word? A priori, there could be an exponentially large search space. You received, there was an intended code word sent to you, but some errors happened. So you received some other code word. It's close to the original one, but you don't know it. So you need to search around the ball, around your string, until you find the code word. Okay, so where do expanders come in? Well, in a really beautiful paper from 1996, Sipser and Spielman gave a way to construct error-correcting codes, to construct linear subspaces that allow both the linear time encoding and decoding. And this construction is based on expanders. So not going to talk about how it works right now. Maybe I'll get to that towards the end of the talk. But a priori, really, I find it you wouldn't expect necessarily that expanders are important for construction of error-correcting codes. Why are they important? Because the way it works is that you use the expansion structure to decide what are the parity checks or the linear constraints of your code. And then to prove the two different code words are far apart, you show that if they are far apart on a single bit, then it implies that they must be far apart on nearby bits on the expander. And from there on nearby bits on the expander, and kind of you use the expansion to show that the distance between the code word propagates and, until you show that it's a large distance. So expansion somehow plays a key role in this argument. Okay, another application of expander graphs, which is maybe more natural, it's less surprising than for error correcting codes, is the application towards the fast mixing of random walks. So think of the following question. Suppose we have some system that's a complicated system, and we want to sample a random configuration from the system. For example, something people like to think about is you have a deck of cards and you want to mix them up. You want to shuffle the cards so that you have a random permutation of the cards so that you can start the game and it's completely fair, right? So how do you sample a random shuffled deck of cards, right? So in this example, you have 52 cards. So there's 52 factorial different permutations and you want a random one. What are you gonna do? Okay, so we know what we do in practice. There's these shuffles that we do and we do it a few times and we somehow believe that that's okay. And really what's going on is that you can think of this graph where every node in the graph is a possible permutation of this deck of cards. So how many nodes do I have here? 52 factorial. It's a huge graph. It's not something that we actually program or anything like that. We just think of it. So we have this huge, huge graph of all the configurations. And we have these shuffle moves that allow us to move from one node to another node. You know, there's an arrow if there's a single shuffle that moves me from this permutation to that permutation. And to convince myself that a certain collection of card shuffles is a good one and it will lead me to a random point in this graph, I need to analyze how does a random walk in this graph behave or how quickly does it converge to the uniform distribution. Okay, so if the graph is an expander and I can prove that, say, by analyzing the eigenvalues of this graph and showing that there's a big gap between the largest and the second largest eigenvalue, then I can prove that random walks in this graph mix rapidly, and then I know how to sample a random configuration. Of course, this whole story with the cards is just an example. People sometimes think of different systems, you know, like maybe physical systems with the particles, or there are many different situations where you want to sample a random configuration. Okay, here's another application in computer science of the expander graphs. And these are the for construction of probabilistically checkable proofs. So let me tell you a little bit about that. So PCPs, this is a very well-known area in theoretical computer science, has had a lot of impact in different directions. Oops. The PCP theorem is already more than 30 years old. It was proven by Arora and Safra and Lund, Motwani, Sudan, and Segedi in the very early 90s. And what the PCP theorem says is that every NP statement, every statement that comes with a witness that can be verified, can actually be compiled or encoded in a way that makes it not only verified, but verified by a very fast verifier. This very fast, ultra fast verifier is going to be randomized, and it will randomly do some random calculation and then decide to read only a constant number of bits from the proof and decide if it's and decide yes or no. And this verifier will succeed with a high probability. So that's kind of a very striking result. It's hard to believe, because when we think of a proof, we think of something very fragile, that, you know, there can be one bug hidden somewhere. And if we read just a random few points in the proof, we won't find the bug. And we will think that the proof is okay, but it's not. And that's true. That's true for a normal, typical NP proof. The beauty of the PCP theorem is that it says, it doesn't say every proof can be verified this way. It says that every NP language, the proofs in it can be compiled into such a way. So that's the content of the theorem. And historically, the way this theorem came about is from the study of complexity and cryptography. People realized that interactive proofs are a very interesting new object where you add both randomness and interaction. And there was a flood of ideas and very new kind of ideas. And this is where the theorem came from. And it turned out very, very quickly that there is an amazing application of this theorem towards a completely different direction. So it's particularly, this theorem has a lot of applications towards the hardness of approximation, proving that certain problems are not only NP hard to calculate exactly, but also approximately. And recently, PCPs have seen a completely different set of amazing applications in cloud computing and cryptocurrency. And there's actually, you know, companies now being that actually use these ideas in practice. So that's quite a stunning development. And what I want to tell you maybe in the next slide is that, like error correcting codes and the Sipter-Spielman codes that I talked about before, also for PCPs, one way to prove the PCP theorem uses expander graphs as a very important component. So this is not the original proof that Arora et al. Gave, but this is the alternative proof that uses expansion. So let's see that. Okay, so this is a one slide description of how PCPs can be built on expanders. So let me try to explain what I mean. If I want to prove the PCP theorem, which says that for every NP language, blah, 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 it's enough for me to prove it for a specific NP language that's NP complete, because then there are reductions from any other language to this NP complete language. So let's focus on graph three coloring. Okay, so in graph three coloring, you're given a graph and the witness is supposed to convince you that this graph is three colorable. Now, the most natural witness would just be a coloring of the vertices. And then to check it, you need to go edge by edge and see that every edge has the two endpoints have different colors. That would mean that indeed this is a valid color. Now, what does the PCP version of this NP proof look like? The PCP version would expect that you take your graph, you create from it another graph, such that in the new graph, not only you know, if the original graph was three colorable, the new graph will also be three colorable. But if your original graph was not three colorable, meaning no matter how you color it, there's going to be some problem, some bug somewhere. In the new graph, you expect that no matter how you color it, many, like 1% of the edges, will see a bad configuration. Namely, they will see the same color on both endpoints. So the new graph needs to be really far from three colorable. No matter how you try to color the vertices, many, many of the edges will say something's going on here, something is wrong. So to prove the PCP theorem, really what we are going to do is construct just a reduction from a graph to another graph so that two things happen. Initially, if the initial graph was three colorable, the new graph will remain three colorable. But if the original graph was not, then the new graph will really be far from three colorable. Many of the edges will reject no matter what coloring you put there. Okay, so that's what we plan to do. Now, how are we going to do it? The idea is to take, use an expander graph as kind of your underlying skeleton of your graph. So let's pretend for a minute, it's not hard to make this happen. Pretend that our graph that we started with is already an expander. So that's not exactly precise, but kind of let's flow with that. And now we're going to do a transformation where every vertex you see here on the right, you start from a graph, but then on the right, every vertex looks at the neighborhood, like a little ball around it, and kind of collects the colors from all of its neighbors. Okay, and so now when you compare two neighboring balls, you don't only ask whether their colors are compatible, but you ask whether all of their neighborhoods are compatible, whether there's no problem among their neighborhoods. And because you had an expander underlying there, if there was some problem, the expansion would kind of cause the problem to propagate. So I'm not going to say much more about this. Can't really explain it on a technical level in such a talk, but I just want to give you the feeling that the whole idea of the PCP transformation is to move from a situation where you have some bug somewhere to a situation where the bug kind of propagate all over the place. And we're going to use expanders for doing that. Kind of the expander will allow us to propagate the bug. Okay, so far I've given a few examples kind of did I get out of the share screen?
Yes, you did.
Do you see this still?
No, you're not sharing anymore.
Oh, not yet. Sorry.
Apologies. Okay, going back. Okay.
Yeah, right? Now good.
Now we can see.
Yes.
I guess I did that because I wanted to check on the time. So I get my phone here so I can see the time. Okay, good. All right, so far I gave a few examples of applications of the expander graphs that we know throughout the years. But let's kind of go back for a minute and talk about expander graphs in themselves. You know, do expander graphs even exist? So already in the 70s, Pinsker showed that a random graph is with high probability an expander graph. So certainly they exist. Okay, this is not so trivial as it sounds. In fact, in the first appearance of expander graphs in the computer science literature, they were initially conjectured not to exist. So, you know, it's not so trivial to think that a graph that every node is connected to only a few neighbors will be so highly connected. But a random graph is a very good expander. And later, some deep results in number theory and group theory were used to give explicit constructions of expander graphs. So there was the construction of Margulis and then the construction by Lubotsky, Phillips, and Cernak, which gave graphs that are optimal. They're called Ramanujan expanders because under some measure, the spectral measure, they're optimal. They have the best possible spectral gap. And these really celebrated constructions, they're very explicit. They're very easy to describe, like to say which node connects to which node. It's very nice and very symmetric. But of course, to prove that they are expanders, it's a little less obvious. You need to do some heavy lifting. And it was really a beautiful result when Reingold, Vadhan, and Victorzon in 2001 came up with a very different, completely elementary construction of expanders. This is the zigzag construction. And this construction is kind of a gradual, you build a small graph, then you enlarge it and you strengthen it and so on, until you get to an expander of any size that you want. And so, you know, by now we have expanders, we have different ways of constructing them. This is very, very good and well understood. I still want to talk a little bit more about the Ramanujan expanders of Lubotsky, Phillips, and Sarnak, because they will allow me to describe later the high dimensional expanders. Okay. So as I said, these expanders are based on some deep number theory. But let me say a couple of words about them. So the way they're constructed is as follows. You start with this object, which is called the infinite D-regular tree. So you start, there is some root node, and then this node has D neighbors, and then each one of them have D neighbors, so D minus one new neighbors and one old neighbor, and you keep going and you keep going to infinity. Okay, so that's the infinite tree. And the thing is that this tree can also be viewed as an infinite Cayley graph of some infinite group. And then you can take a subgroup and take a quotient so that suddenly from this infinite object, you get a finite object, okay? And that's what LPS did. They showed that certain finite quotients of this infinite tree are very, very good in terms of their spectrum, their eigenvalues. Their eigenvalues behave optimally in some sense. Okay, so kind of, but conceptually, locally, you always look like the infinite tree, and then somewhere later on, there's a quotient going on, making your object finite. Okay, this has had tremendous success in many, many applications. But now we can ask, what would be the analog of this construction in higher dimension? Okay. So Lubotsky, after the success of the Lubotsky-Phillips-Sarnak construction, knew that the math was available, or this is the story that he tells, to do the same thing for higher dimension. And they set out to do so with Samuels and Vishnia. So here, instead of the infinite tree, you have some other high dimensional infinite object, which is called the infinite Buratitz building. Really what you have is, instead of a vertex and edges and edges and edges all the way to infinity, you have like a triangle, and on every edge of the triangle, there are more triangles, like a little book of triangles. And then from every one of those triangles, on every one of their edges, there's more triangles and more triangles all the way to infinity. So it's similar to the infinite tree. It's the infinite, it's called the building. Okay. What mathematical object is it? It's a simplicial complex. You have here vertices and edges like we did before, but you also have these triples, which we call triangles. Okay, so now what LSV did, they said, okay, I start with this infinite vertex building, just like they start with the infinite tree. And I use a sub, and sorry, I forgot to say, and there's a way to think of this object. There's a group acting on this object. And if you take a subgroup of this group, you can quotient by it and you get a finite object. Okay, so that's what they did. And okay, they got their infinite sequence of finite simplicial complexes that come from these Buratitz buildings. It's really a beautiful construction. It involves some very deep mathematics. So you might say it's a little bit inaccessible, but it turns out that there are ways to understand it. So for example, we can study random walks on this object and start to get a grip on what's going on here. So by the way, when we look at random walks on this object, this is a simplicial complex, it's not only a random walk that goes from vertex to vertex to vertex. We can now also talk about a random walk that goes from edge to a triangle containing this edge and then to another edge and keep on going like that, edge, triangle, and so on. So there are different random walks here and we study all of them, and it turns out that, you know, they are optimal in some sense. Okay, so just to reiterate, the object that we now look at is no longer a graph. Really, maybe the most natural thing that I would guess before I learned about all these things, what is a higher dimensional version of a graph? It should be a hypergraph. Instead of just edges, I would guess that I need hyper edges. So every hyper edge has, say, 3 vertices. But a simplicial complex is almost that, except if you already have a hyper edge, you need to also have all the subsets of that hyper edge. So you, if you have a triangle, you also have all the 3 edges. That's not so important. It's just a very smooth way of thinking about these things, because then these random walks are well defined. So it makes sense to look at them this way. And then we can look at all these random walks that we discussed, from edge to triangle to edge and so on. And one way that turned out quite useful for studying these objects is to look at them locally, piece by piece. So we look at something called a link. So if you have such a huge simplicial complex given to you by, you know, from this number theory ideas, it's very hard to understand what this object is and how it looks like, but it's a bit easier to look at little pieces. So these little pieces are the links. Let's see what they are. So this is a drawing of some abstract simplicial complex. And now let's look at a specific vertex, the one here in the middle. What is the link of this vertex? So the link of this vertex, it's like the neighborhood. It's basically, you look at all the vertices that are neighbors of this vertex in the graph with the edges. These vertices are going to be the vertices of the link. And now whenever 2 vertices in the link are connected with your vertex by a triangle, you put an edge in the link graph. So here, the link of this vertex is a graph with 5 vertices and 5 edges. It's the 5 cycle in this specific example. More generally, the link is not only a collection of vertices that are your neighbors, it's this plus the edge structure between them that's coming from the triangles involving the vertex whose link we are taking and these other neighbors of this vertex. So now a link is a very local piece because it's only the vertices that touch your specific vertex. It might be very small, but it might have some interesting graph structure. And a wonderful theorem of Isaac Oppenheim from a few years ago, and really modeled on a theorem of Garland from 50 years ago, is the following. If locally every one of the links is an expander, so this green graph that you see here, not only is it connected, but it's actually an expander in some very easy to specify quantitative way, then the entire connected component, the entire complex that's connected to it, is a high dimensional expander, or in particular, it's just an expander.
Okay, maybe so you can say how, what are the links in this graph before we take any factorization, any quotient? What are the links? Is there some?
Okay. Thanks for the question. So, if we look at the Brotitz building, and we can ask there, what are the links? Even before I'll say what they are, I can say that when we take the quotient, because the quotient is kind of a very good quotient and nothing local collapses, the links in the Brotitz building are identical to the links after the quotient. So I don't even need to understand the quotient to understand the links. It's enough for me to understand the links in the infinite building, which is much easier. And indeed, the links in the infinite building are what's called there's a name for it. It's called the spherical building, but there's a very simple combinatorial description of it. If we're talking about the two-dimensional building, then the link of every single vertex, it looks like a graph that is just the incidence graph of the points versus lines in the projective plane. So if you have some a prime P, there is a projective plane over the finite field with P elements, and you have a P squared plus P plus one points and P squared plus P plus one lines, and you can connect the point to a line if the point sits on that line. So you get a bipartite graph. This is what your link will look like. That just so happens to be the case in the Brotitz building over the P-elements. So
what are the parts then? So we have some vertex. So it's a vertex of several triangles, and so right. We have edges. But what are so this edges for one vertex corresponds to what in this projective plane?
Ah, so we have one vertex, and its neighbors turn out to have two different types. One type of neighbor are all the points in the projective plane. One type of neighbor are all the lines in the projective plane. So far, I only said who are the neighbors. I didn't say who are the edges. So what I have here, five different points, I will have here two times P squared plus P plus one. So I have one set of neighbors for the lines, one set of neighbors for the points. And who will be the edges in the link? It will be whenever a point sits inside a line, they will be neighbors.
Okay, yeah, still not clear why there are two types of neighbors. In the geometric construction, it seems that they are just kind of triangles and they are all the same. But okay, if it's okay.
I agree. Okay, think of it this way. In the infinite tree, when you describe it, you don't think that there's two colors of neighbors, but you also agree with me that the infinite tree is two colorable, right? You can start with the color white and then black and then white and then black. So there is a natural three coloring of this Brotitz building, and this factors into this thing. Okay, but actually this is really beautiful and interesting, and it's really not, you don't really need to know a lot of deep math to understand it. It's nice combinatorics, and we can certainly grasp it. But let me move on. I mean, I'm happy to take any questions for clarification, though. So if there's any more question.
So Irit, what you're stating is the following. Like in this example, in the picture, the link of it was a phi cycle. In the Brotitz building of dimension two, the link will be of a link of every vertex will be a bipartite graph, which is the point line incidence graph.
That's right. That's right. Okay. So that just, so happens to be what it is. And that's in the infinite building. But even after we take this LSV quotient, the quotient doesn't harm the local structure, so it will still be the same. And now there's this phenomenon that we didn't have in the one-dimensional case, which is that now we can deduce expansion of the entire graph or other properties maybe of the entire graph by properties of just the links. And this is what Galland did 50 years ago. He was interested in understanding something called the real cohomology of this building, okay? So it's some global property of the entire complex. And he proved that because he understands very well what's going on in the links, in fact, that the real cohomology is zero there, and because he has expansion in the links, he can prove that the whole real cohomology is zero, it vanishes. So that's what Garland did. And used the local structure of the links to prove some global property. And what Oppenheim showed is more that this is really, he gave a simpler and more general theorem with using roughly the same proof. It says, look, if you have any simplicial complex, it doesn't have to be coming from the Bruttitz building. You have some simplicial complex. If you know that all the links are expanders, and if you know that it's connected, so I can look at every connected component separately. If you know that all the links are expanders, then the entire graph is an expander. So it's a local condition for expansion. And the reason this is so beautiful and striking is because in a one-dimensional graph, we don't have anything, any such thing. In a one-dimensional graph, the link or the neighborhood is just a collection of vertices. The graph can have high girth, so that means your neighbors will have no edges among them. And you can have examples of high girth graphs that, you know, one example is a good expander and one example is a very poor expander. So there's no hope of deducing some global structure from these empty links. Okay, so to finish this slide, I just want to say that even if maybe I lost you in the details of how these things work, or I didn't really go into the details, there is some phenomenon going on here that allows you to move from local information on the links to the global picture. And that's gonna be useful. And so now let me show you a couple of applications in CS for this fact. So the first one is this beautiful result that shows that certain random walks mix quickly. And this was an open conjecture for many years, the Mihail Vazirani conjecture. And it was proven 4 years ago by Anari, Liu, Ovesgaran, and Vinzant. What they showed is that for any matroid, you can sample a random random basis by a very natural random walk. So let me unpack this. So a matroid, there's some collection of axioms. I don't want to get into it. So let's think of a concrete example of a matroid. So think of a graph and the matroid, or the basis of the matroid will be all possible spanning trees in this graph. So now, suppose I want to sample a random spanning tree in this graph. Okay, this is just an example. The more general theorem says you can sample a random matroid basis. Okay, but I want to sample a random spanning tree. Already Mihail and Vazirani suggested a kind of a very natural random walk that you can do to start from some spanning tree. And then what would you do? So you start with some spanning tree in your graph. You add some edge from the graph that's not in the spanning tree. Now you close the loop. So you can remove one of the edges in this loop, remove one at random. Now you got a new spanning tree and you can keep going like that. So that's a very, I would say, natural procedure. And you can think of it as a random walk on a state of all configurations. So remember when we talked about the cards and the shuffles and you had this huge graph of all the configurations. So it's the same thing. You can think of the graph where every node in the graph is a spanning tree and you connect two of them if you get from one to the other through this simple step that I just described. But it was not known how to analyze random walks on this graph. How fast do they mix? I mean, the graph, the number of different nodes is like the number of spanning trees. It's exponential in the size of the graph. Will you get to a random location in polynomial time? It's unclear. So what was the idea of this group of people? They said, no, we're not gonna look at a graph and analyze its expansion. We're gonna look at a high dimensional simplicial complex and analyze its expansion this way. So what they did is not put each spanning tree as a node. Instead, they put each spanning tree as a face in a simplicial complex, like as a triangle, but not a triangle, but rather a higher dimensional simplex. Okay, so what they did is that they constructed a simplicial complex. The nodes in the simplicial complex are the edges in the graph that we want to find them a spanning tree. And each spanning tree is a collection of edges, right? So it's itself, it's a face. in this implicit complex, and they closed it downward. So every sub-spanning tree is also a face, and that's how they create their simplicial complex. And now they want to analyze this walk that moves from a big face, remove one edge, so they move to a face of dimension one less, and then move back up to another big face. So it's like moving from triangle to edge to triangle to edge, but these triangles now have dimension n minus two, because they have n minus one edges. In a spanning tree, you have n minus one edges. So, and the way they analyzed it is to look at the links. So just, I have here a picture. So the random walk, you see that you move from one, I guess in this picture, you're supposed to think of, this is your graph, and the blue edges are supposed to be, no, I guess the black edges are supposed to be the spanning tree. And now you remove this edge from the spanning tree and you add this one, and so on and so on. But the idea was to think of these objects as high dimensional faces. And so you add something and remove something, add something and remove something. And the point is to analyze this random walk. It's very complicated. Now you look at just the local links, like we looked at the vertex and everything around it. Now you will look at some sub-spanning tree and everything around it. And if I had a few more minutes, I would actually be able to show you the proof. It's really beautiful, and it's really easy. The analysis kind of writes itself almost. It's really a good way to view these things. Okay, so moving on to another TCS application for high dimensional expanders. I said in the beginning of my talk that error correcting codes sometimes are constructed based on expanders. And so it's natural to expect that maybe if you have a high dimensional expander, you can get new properties from your error correcting codes. So indeed, even the Simons Institute at Berkeley was generous to give us a summer cluster to explore this. And they drew for us this beautiful picture where you see in the bottom the geometrical structure of the high dimensional expander. And on top, you have here the maybe the logic of the code or the bits, I don't know. Okay, so what kind of new properties can high dimensional expanders give us? So in the work with the Harsha, Kaufman, Livni, Navon, and Tashma, we showed that you can get new codes from expanders that not only can you decode them, you can also list decode them by list decoding separately the local pieces that make up the high dimensional expander. So that's one result. This was actually vastly strengthened and generalized and used to find the algorithm for decoding and list decoding these almost optimal codes by Tashma. So I'm not going to get into it, but it seems that having local structures is indeed useful. And the second application that's more recent, and we mentioned at the beginning, is the construction of locally testable codes with constant rate, distance, and locality. Sometimes this is called the C-cubed question. So let me just say a few words of motivation to this question. When you have an error correcting code and you receive a word, it's supposed to be a code word, but some noise maybe happened. You want to check very quickly how much noise happened. It's not so clear if you can do that, but if you have a locally testable code, it will allow you to do this very fast estimation of how many errors happen. And this might remind you of how we discussed the PCP theorem, where in a PCP proof, you get some NP witness, like coloring of a graph. And it's not, if there is a problem, you will be able to find it by just random probing, because if there is a problem, it will be all over the place. So indeed, locally testable codes, they come from the world of PCPs. And they're a special kind of property testing. Property testing is this area that studies the relation between global properties and small local views. And locally testable codes, you want to test the global property of belonging to the code by looking at small parts of the code word. So we recently, with Evra, Livne, Lubotsky, and Moses, we showed how to construct LTCs with constant rate and distance based on objects like these high dimensional expanders. Previously, I mean, the development of this whole area of LTCs came hand in hand with PCPs. And even for the proof of the PCP theorem 30 years ago, they developed technology for constructing LTCs. So LTCs are known already for 30 years, but all of these LTCs that we knew, all of them had very small rate, like going to zero. And whereas codes are considered to be good if they have constant rate, and random codes are have good constant rate and distance. But random codes are really not LTC. The only LTCs that we knew had vanishing rate. And this is the first time that we saw codes with non-vanishing rate. And the idea is just like in the Sipser-Spielman construction where you put the bits on an expander, here also you put the bits on, say, like the triangles of this high-dimensional expander, and you use the local to global to kind of propagate the local to stability from the links to the entire complex. I'll see in a minute if I have enough time. I have another, yeah, I think I have enough time. I have another slide or two to show the idea without describing for you the exact code. I just want to show some idea of how the high dimensional expansion is relevant for this issue. But before, I just want to mention that simultaneous to our work, there was a work by a completely different set of people, Pantelev and Kalachev, that came up with almost exactly the same construction. And they showed that it's an LTC. And moreover, they showed that really this object is a quantum LDPC. So that's some different kind of object. And it's very interesting, but I don't have, of course, time to talk about it. Just wanted to point out this in case people are interested. It's a really beautiful piece of work. And there's been several follow-ups since then. So, okay. So now I'm not going to describe the code or anything like that. I want to describe something that's like a bit of a fake construction. It's not a real construction, but it's supposed to help understand something basic about how high dimensional expansion helps us. Okay, so first I want to talk about how to put a code on a geometrical object like a graph or a simplicial complex. So here I have these two arrows. Basically I have V is a set of vertices of a graph, E is a set of edges of a graph, and T is a set of triangles. Okay, so now how do I use this to build some linear subspace, some error correcting thing? I can look at functions mapping, say, putting a bit on every vertex. So that's now a space, a linear space. All the functions from the vertices to GF2. Okay, so let's look at the picture. Okay, so let's first look at the left-hand side of the picture. So I have some simplicial complex. Here it's a very simple one with one triangle, but think of something bigger. And I'm looking at functions on the vertices. So this vertex gets a zero, this vertex gets a zero, and this vertex gets a one. This is an example of a function. Now I can use the map from vertices to edges to take this function on the vertices and create from it a function on the edges. Very simple. This edge takes the sum of the bits on its two endpoints. So zero plus one equals one. So this edge gets a one. This edge gets the sum of its two endpoints. So zero plus zero gets a zero. And this edge is the same thing. Okay, so now we use the arrow from V to E to take a function on the vertices and create from it a function on the edges. Okay, we can do it again since we can now move from E to T, from edges to triangles. I can now take the function that I constructed on the edges and create from it a function on the triangles. What will the triangle do? It will just look at all of the three edges that participate in the triangle and sum up the three bits. So this triangle will take one plus one plus zero, comes up to be a zero. So this triangle got a zero.
But it's always zero because you count every vertex twice.
Ah, thank you. Ah, wonderful. Yes. I could never get a one on the triangle, right? Why? Because like Alexander said, this vertex gave its value both to this edge and to this edge, right? And this vertex gave its value twice, both to this edge and to this edge and so on. So it will always be zero, okay? So this is, okay, good. So this is what we call a chain of linear maps. And it has this property you write it in a math like this, but the meaning of this is just that when you apply the map twice, you always get zero. You move from vertices to edges to triangles, you got zero. And the way we write it here is to say the image of the first map from V to E, so any function on the edges that came from vertices, when you map it to the triangles, it's zero. So it belongs to the kernel of the second map. Okay, so you got here a chain of linear maps, and that's something useful sometimes, especially if you also have expansion in the background. So why is that? So now we are going to define a code. Our code is going to really be a fake code. It's not going to be any good, but let's ignore that. Our code is going to be all the functions on the vertices that when you map them to the edges, you get zero. So every edge, when it sums the values, it gets zero. Now, if you look at it for a second, you'll see that it's a trivial code, but allow this to me, maybe think of, you can generalize this with the local systems of coefficients in a way that's non-trivial. You can put like little strings on every vertex, and then when you map them together, it won't be so trivial. So let's, for a minute, not worry whether this code is good or not. Just think that I have a code where the edges specify which parity checks I do. So every edge is like a parity check. It checks the parity of its two endpoints. And that specifies a linear subspace, and I'm going to call this subspace my error correcting thing. Now, because I always have the delta of delta is zero, I know that if I have some string that's not in my code, but it's close to my code, it satisfies almost all of the parity checks, then it means that, you know, maybe some edge is bad. But because the triangle sums to zero, if this edge is bad, it's a one, there must be some other edge in this triangle that's also a one. So if there is some problem locally, it will propagate elsewhere and elsewhere and elsewhere. And if you have an expansion property like this random walk expands, then you can show that kind of the problems propagated everywhere. And conceptually, like in the proof of the PCP theorem, the expansion shows you that if you had some problem somewhere, it will you will be able to detect it everywhere. Okay, so I have a slide on this called the fake construction of LTC. The code, as we said, it's functions on the vertices that satisfy the edge parity checks. Just to say, the real code that we construct, it's not on the vertices, but rather on the triangles, or we have squares, so it's on the squares. But conceptually, a similar thing is going on. And what you need to prove that something is an LTC, you want to prove the following thing, that if you have some string that satisfies almost all of the parity checks, the edge checks, then there is a way to fix it so that it satisfies all of them. So in other words, if you satisfy almost everything, you are close to something that satisfies everything. And that's in general not a property of a code. In a random error correcting code, absolutely not. If you satisfy all the parity checks except one, you might be very, very far from the code. This is actually a theorem of Harsha, Rashkodnikova, and Ben Sasson, showing that for a random code, it's very, very far from an LTC. So how do we prove it? What we show is that suppose we have a word that satisfies almost all of the checks. We run this iterative algorithm that locally does some optimization. Every vertex, if it sees that almost all of the checks around it are unhappy, it will flip its value. And we keep going until we get stuck and we cannot do any more improvement. And at that point, we do this analysis. And we show that using the high dimensional expansion, if at that point we didn't converge to a real code word, there must be problems everywhere. If there's one problem, there must be more problems and more problems. And so the high dimensional expansion kind of helps us prove that this algorithm converges. Okay, so I guess that's it. Let me just summarize. I talked a little bit about expanders, and then I talked about high dimensional expanders. ensure that they support local to global statements. So you can deduce global properties from local structure. These objects are kind of very fun to study. They give really beautiful connections between deep mathematical ideas and constructions and computer science questions. And I feel that there's room for many other maybe applications that we haven't even looked at yet. Really, it's like a new playground to explore. It's a collection of objects that we never even imagined that such objects can exist, at least I can say for myself. When I first saw these things, they looked completely paradoxical. And so they must lead to, you know, different counterexamples or algorithms. So I invite you all to look at these objects. Okay.
Thanks, Irit. Any questions?
So now I understand a bit what the combinatorial topology is for, but this fake code, there is something which I don't understand. So there are these two mappings, two differentials from one dimension, two dimension to three dimension. But in explanation of the code, somehow you used only the kernel of the first mapping.
Define the code. I only use the kernel of the first mapping. That's right.
Yeah, and so to check analyze the code, what is the role of the second mapping? This.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, it's an excellent question. So to define the code, only use the kernel of the first mapping. Maybe I can go to the picture. Yeah. So I only use the kernel of the first mapping. But the fact that the second mapping exists means that it gives me linear dependencies between the parity checks, because I know that if two of the edges sum up, like this one is a one and this one is a zero, because the sum of every triangle needs to be zero, I know already what the value of the third parity check is. So really the way I think about it is I describe the code by a redundant set of parity checks, because every three edges that participate in a triangle, they're already linearly dependent.
Okay, so you cannot just violate one. Yeah.
Right. So usually when we describe, say, a random code, we just describe a bunch of linear parity checks, and they're all independent. Here, we found a way to describe a linear space with built-in redundancy. And this redundancy helps us. We know already in property testing that redundancy is very useful. And here, this redundancy with the expansion helps us to prove that the algorithm converges.
It is somehow important how much the kernel is larger than the image. This is called the homology thing, or not.
Right, the homology measure is exactly why there's no, whether, well, okay, if there's equality here in the, when I wrote subset, they can be equal or they can be different from each other. In the quantum LDPC code, really what's going on is that the code is in this difference, is the homology. So if you want good dimension for the quantum LDPC code, you want a big homology. In the LTCs, it's a bit different, but yeah.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Any further questions? Actually, Irit, I have a question. So you mentioned about how the amazing applications of high-dimensional expansion and early on expansion. Do some of these connections go the other way? That is, do we have to study expansion, high dimensional expansion for some of these objects? For locally testability, is high dimensional expansion required? And or for codes, is there an underlying, given any good code, is there an underlying expander or some sort of expander sitting under it?
Okay, oh, nice question. So Prahlad is asking a question. He gives me an LTC. Is there an underlying high dimensional expander in there? Is that your question?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. I don't know, but it would be interesting to look into that. Or like, I guess a PCP or an LTC, all of these objects, if you start from them, can you construct something, some new high dimensional expanders? You know that in the story about expander graphs, first there were these number theory constructions, Margulis and Lubotsky-Phillips-Sarnak. And then there was the zigzag construction, which is elementary. And in the PCP, the expander-based proof is like the zigzag construction. Maybe there's also an analogous construction of a high-dimensional expander with a zigzag kind of thing. But I don't know how to do it. I mean, I tried and failed, but that doesn't mean a lot, so.
And no other question, let's thank Irit again. So conclude the session and we'll meet again in 30 minutes for the next, for the regular conference talks. Thank you.